We've got two speakers today. We've got John Parrington, Associate Professor in Molecular and Cellular Pharmacology at the University of Oxford, author of a number of books including Redesigning Life and the Deeper Genome, number of books we've got on bookmarks upstairs. And I would also like to welcome Suzanne Jeffery, and she is the chair of the Campaign Against Climate Change, and she's speaking in her personal capacity today. Both speakers will speak for about 20-25 minutes, and then I'll open it up to obviously discussion, questions and contributions from the floor. So obviously invite people to think about any questions you've got, what thoughts you have as the speakers are speaking. Let me therefore start with John.
Thank you very much for the invitation to talk today. I've had a great debate in the first session. So what I want to talk about today really is to look at how Marxists look at science and partly how we create science and understand science under capitalism, but also looking forward to how we do science differently in the social society. And I want to just use genetics as an area to look at, partly because I am a geneticist, but just obviously we can't talk about the whole of science in 20 minutes. Now, I thought it was worth before I do that, first of all, looking at some of the ways that Marxists in particular approach science and scientific discovery. So I think one of the first things to say about Marxism is that it's a form of materialism. We very much believe there is a real world out there and that we can learn more about that real world by doing scientific experiment observation, but it's not like, you know, it's just an illusion. There really is a real world out there. Having said that, you know, as the quotes with Marx and Lenin here show, that we have the view of the real world that it's what we can grasp from it, from looking at it and doing experiments, is always an approximation of what's really out there. So Marx said if the essence of objects coincided with the form of their outer manifestations, then every science would be superfluous. And it wasn't obvious to people that it's actually the Earth that goes around the Sun, not the other way around. And that's true in general of scientific discovery, that it actually means uncovering things that may not be obvious to common sense. Lenin said something similar when he said human knowledge does not follow a straight line, but a curve which endlessly approximates a series of circles or spiral. We're always kind of circling around the truth. That doesn't mean there isn't real truth to be discovered. And I think it's worth saying that because some more recent kind of viewpoints like postmodernism recently have gone against this idea that there is actually a real world out there that we can understand and know, and there is such a thing as truth. Now, the other important aspect of the way Marxists look at science and scientific discovery is that we are critical of ideas developed in any particular class of society. So, for instance, there's a quote by Engels here. This is Engels supporting a beard. I'm sure any hipster would kill for, actually. So he's obviously ahead of his time in that respect. But also Engels had some really important things to say about science. So on the one hand, he was one of the first people to read Darwin's Origin of Species. In its first edition, he was one of the ones who snapped up the first edition. And he said in a letter to Marx that this was a really splendid development, this ability of Darwin to see that there was an evolutionary process, a theory of natural selection. But at the same time, he was also aware that because this had been developed within bourgeois society in capitalist society, there was actually a problem in the way that the theory of natural selection was phrased, and that it had really taken over many of the assumptions of capitalist society about competition and these kind of things. And although it was an important step forward as a theory, it does hold some of those contradictions of capitalist society with it. So, you know, the whole idea of the survival of the fittest is true to an extent of nature, but it's also only one way of looking at nature. We now know actually that there's as much cooperation in nature as there is competition, and so it's kind of one-sided view of what's really going on. And I think one of the important things that we can say also about Marx's view of science and the natural world, which really can sometimes confuse and confound some people, is this idea that there's a dialectical way of looking at the world. You know, it sounds like an odd word, dialectics, and kind of puts some people off, but it really is quite an important aspect of Marxism that it sees contradiction and contradictions, and they can develop, and nature itself can go through contradictions in its development. And our way of understanding nature and also society is dialectic in the sense that we go through these kind of it's basically about an idea of looking at nature as a moving thing, and society as a moving thing rather than static way that we sometimes get in the mainstream social sciences today. And I think so Lenin realised this when he was talking about the importance of Hegel's, you know, theories for Marx, and people might want to say more about that. I'm not really going to say any more. What I would say is that when scientists first got a chance to really work in a kind of a Marxist philosophy framework after the Russian Revolution, people like Vygotsky, I think, had a massive impact on the way we understand how the mind works. He did actually say quite specifically that it was using Marx's method that was crucial to how he came to reformulate our ideas about the mind. And he didn't want to just discover the nature of mind by taking over, you know, existing kind of way of looking at the mind from bourgeois science, but to build a kind of study of the mind using this dialectical method. And now I want to move on to talk very briefly about genetics in the kind of remaining 15 minutes or 20 minutes that I've got. So it's going to be very much a whistle-stop tour of genetics and the new science of genome editing, but I want to just pull out some of the things that I think are exciting about what we've learned about how genes work, and also some of the contradictions. And I think here Marxism does have a role to play in making us realise that, well, actually things are often more complicated than we sometimes get from reading about genetics in the mainstream media and some popular science books. So I think one thing to say is that we really can't understand genetics, so this is basically how characteristics are passed down through generations, without having also the theory of evolution. Now people will have heard of Darwin's theory of natural selection, I mentioned it earlier on. This is basically the idea that in a population there are variants, and it's the differential ability to survive in that environment that leads some particularly fit individuals to be able to survive, pass on their characteristics to the next generation. And that was a major step forward in understanding that there actually is this thing called evolution that's happening out there in the world, and a mechanism. And that's often counterposed to another person, Lamarck, who actually came up with the first theory of evolution back in around the time of the French Revolution, and often he's ridiculed for his ideas about evolution. And yet, as I'll point out later on, actually, maybe he was actually a lot more to Lamarck than often made out. So out of a revolutionary era, the French Revolution, came a revolutionary theory, because he was really the first person to really say that there was this thing called evolution. And for this, he was, you know, pilloried by all sorts of people, seen as very subversive and threatening, really, even within that kind of revolution situation, partly because already, you know, it was moving towards a less revolutionary phase. But one thing Lamarck said, so this is the example that's often given, is you can see this picture of these giraffes and how they've evolved, and how giraffes started off quite small and then got bigger. And on the far side is the one I've already mentioned, the kind of Darwin's view, which is that there are smaller and larger giraffes, and it's the ones that happen to be slightly larger that can reach the nicest leaves on the top of the tree, that they're ones that survive and pass on their characteristics to the next generation. Whereas Lamarck said, well, it's almost like the striving to reach those leaves in itself somehow changes the next generation. And the reason it's been ridiculed is because there was no way, there was no obvious mechanism there for how this could happen. So we often hear that Lamarck is just this kind of figure of fun. And yet, as I'll show, maybe there's a bit more to Lamarck than we originally thought. Now let's skip forward a bit. And think about, well, the actual founding of genetics as a field. So actually it's interesting that the guy called Gregor Mendel, so there's a type of, should say, Gregor of Mendel, it's Gregor Mendel. Anybody who thinks that religion and science are always completely opposed, it's worth mentioning that Mendel was actually a monk, later an abbot, but that didn't stop him discovering the foundations of genetics, really, and he did this using pea plants. He actually initially was going to work on mice, but when the local bishop found that he was planning to watch mice copulating in his blood, he said, no, you can't do that. This is you're a celibate monk, no mice in your blood. So Mendel had to work on pea plants instead. As he pointed out at the time, it was lucky the bishop didn't know that plants also have sex. Now, what's the importance of Mendel's discoveries about genetics? Well, he basically showed that if you study simple characteristics like, you know, green colour or yellow colour or the size of a stem of a pea plant, and then follow these through generations, you can see that they can be thought of as like pairs of characteristics. You might have green versus yellow, and one will be dominant to the other. So in general, if you think they're in pairs, if there's two yellows, you'll always get yellow. If you've got a yellow and a green characteristic, then it will also be yellow because that masks the effects of the green. And it's only if you get the two green instructions together that you get the being officer. So this idea of recessive and dominant, as he called it, it was important because we now know that that's true of some human characteristics. So some human diseases like cystic fibrosis, single gene disorder, is a recessive disorder, whereas Huntington's is a dominant disorder. Cystic fibrosis particularly causes a problem with the lungs and the digestive system. Huntington's a premature form of dementia that is very troubling for the people who get this in midlife. Now I would say this was a major step forward out of understanding of how characteristics have passed on. It was actually a vital complement to Darwin's theory, because it's really only with this idea that there is these factors, as Mendel called them, which we now call genes, that carry instructions for the characteristics, that we can see how characteristics can become selected for and passed down, and then eventually start to determine the evolution of a species. Now, surprisingly, having discovered this, Mendel's ideas were then ignored for about 40 years, so he actually came up with his findings about the same time as Darwin's Original Species, about 5 years after. But most people didn't see the significance, and it was only in 1900 that his ideas were rediscovered. And then the problem was that although there was these things called genes, people really didn't understand what was the chemical nature of these. And it took actually another 50 years after the rediscovery of Mendel's work in 1900 that we finally realised that it's DNA that's the molecule of life. And this is the famous picture of Watson and Crick, who came up with this double helix, a model that you may have heard about on DNA, using data that they partially stole from Rosalind Franklin, a scientist working at King's College. And the important thing about this model, the structure of DNA, is that it shows that we can think of DNA as a kind of a code. So essentially there are letters in the DNA, and these can be then read to make proteins which do all the different things in the cell. And so you've got a kind of an idea of a code, the code of life, you might have heard of that expression. That didn't tell us actually how genes are actually switched on and off. It took that the work of two French scientists, Jacques Monod and François Jacob, who came up with the discovery that it's actually proteins that switch genes on and off. This was while Jacques Monod was fighting in the French Resistance, fighting the Nazis in the Second World War. So just shows you can actually be highly political and science. Now, let's skip forward quite a bit and move to the Human Genome Project, because this has been quite contentious, you know, what we learned from the human genome, what was the point of all this. Human genome was basically using new technology to sequence all the letters in the human genome, so all the genes in the genome of a human. And I say it's contentious because big claims were made for that project. So, for instance, Francis Collins said, what more powerful form of study of mankind could there be than to read our own instruction book? But then you can see a criticism of this from Stephen Rose, a neuroscientist in this country. So Francis Collins was the guy who led the project, who said they said it was the greatest achievement since landing a man on the moon. One even said it ranked with the discovery of the wheel. And yet none of this cornucopia of benefits has come out of it. Now I would say that while it is quite right to be critical of the naive kind of views that we used to originally, you know, make big claims about the genome, but the idea we could just sort of read the DNA and understand what it means to be human, and even just then say, well, we can now cure all, you know, diseases like not just cystic fibrosis and muscular dystrophy and these single gene disorders, but even things like, you know, schizophrenia and autism and all these things that, and all the rest of it. What we're actually learning is the more we actually study the genome is just how complicated it is. And I would say this is actually a sign of why science is a very important project. Although you may start off with some quite naive assumptions about what you're looking at, actually the very process of doing science also means you sometimes have to stand back and say, well, actually we got that bit wrong. It's a bit like what Lenin was saying earlier on about the fact we were only kind of spying around the truth. It's only by doing the science, getting stuck in and actually trying to understand reality, that we actually learn that sometimes our ideas are actually quite false and we have to rephrase them. And one of the biggest, surprises about sequencing the human genome was the discovery that only 2% of the genome is genes. Now that might seem odd, because surely a genome is the sum of the genes. Well, apparently not, because the traditional idea of a gene, protein coding genes, is actually only part of it. It turns out the other 98% of the genome is not coding for proteins, but is actually doing all sorts of important things in the regulation of those genes, and even beyond that. Another important thing we're finding out is that we've been used to thinking of chromosomes, which are the basic units of the genome, very much as linear elements, based on the fact that at a certain stage in cell division, you do actually see the chromosomes kind of, you know, like these linear elements, and you even have the genetic maps that have been made of characteristics. And yet, the more we learn about real genomes in a living cell, the more we realise that these are actually complex 3D structures in which genes come together, genes interact. Parts of the genome that are very distant on a linear sense may actually come together and influence each other. And the other important side of all this is that this is a dynamic process. The environment of the cell affects the way the 3D aspect is working. Another big kind of you know, something that goes against previous ideas about how genomes work is the fact that the genome is a much more mobile, much more kind, it's much less static than we thought. So when I said that the genome's dynamic, I mean that in its sort of 3D aspect, but even the very idea of a linear chromosome with genes dotted along it is starting to be contradicted by the fact that we're now discovering that there's actually elements within the genome that can hop around. And this is particularly the work of a visionary scientist called Barbara McClintock, who you may not have ever heard of. She got a Nobel Prize, but many people have never heard of her. But I think is one of the greatest geneticists of the 20th century. And she discovered that there are these elements within the genome that can actually move around. Now, sometimes these are just portrayed as being part of the so-called junk DNA, parasitical elements. McClintock went much further than that and actually said they play an important creative role within evolution. So it turns out that, you know, in the major evolutionary transitions, like the change from invertebrate to vertebrate, ape to man, ape to humans, there actually seems to have been an increase in these movements in the genome. And it's really, I think, challenging this very idea of gradualism that we've grown up with Darwin, this idea that you get this slow change in genomes, mutations over millions of years, and instead it's seen actually the genome is maybe a more dynamic, much more kind of changes much more radically in a shorter space of time than we'd ever thought. Now the thing that's binding together these discoveries that we're making about the complexity of the genome is this discovery that there's a thing called epigenetics as opposed to genetics, which is basically this idea that the genome is very sensitive to change in the environment. So although the sequence of letters only changes, you know, slowly over millions of years, what we're realising is that chemical changes in the genome in the lifetime of a person can have an impact on that genome. It turns out there are things like stress, anxiety and early life seem to have an impact on the genome. It's unfortunate that a lot of the studies focus on things like stress and anxiety and, you know, that family backgrounds and all that kind of thing. There's probably as much reason to think that actually positive experiences, you know, picket line, going on a demonstration, may also impact upon the genome. We don't really know because people are not really studying these things, but it's an important caution to people who only talk about the epigenetics as being about, you know, the negative things. But what it does show is, just as Lamarck originally said, that actually an individual's lifetime experiences do actually have an impact on their you know, genome. And there is evidence, though again this is quite controversial, that what your parents and what your grandparents did may have a more direct impact on your genome than we'd ever thought. Right, so that's the first thing I wanted to talk about, actually genetics itself. And I want to move on to talking about engineering genomes, because this is, I think, it's an important thing to talk about really, in terms of, you know, how can we use genetics in a way that can be a benefit to the world, but also raises many issues about safety and security, and all the things that can go wrong when we meddle with the natural world. Because there's really, we're in the middle of a revolution in genetic engineering at the moment called genome editing that I think goes so far beyond anything we've been able to do in the past that I think it's very exciting on the one hand, in the potential it raises for us as a species in the way we can manipulate and modify the world. But it does raise all sorts of issues about who controls this and where it's all leading. So I think one of the first things to say is that although, you know, we talk about genetic engineering, we often think of it as a very kind of high-tech modern thing. You could argue in a broader sense we've been engineering genomes for 12,000 years, ever since we first started to settle in fixed place in the world and cultivate crops and animals. We did change their genomes unconsciously in a sense, but we did actually change their genomes by selecting for maize or pigs or cows or wheat or all these things that we think now is natural but are actually products of human interference. But certainly if we're thinking about genetic engineering in the kind of more traditional sense, then we can really point to, thank you, we can really point to a big step forward in the 1970s when scientists first learned how to cut and paste DNA in a test tube. This is Herbert Boyer and Stanley Cohen who first did this. Now importantly, this has had implications for medicine. It's now possible to take the human insulin gene, stick this in a bacteria and make human insulin. It's also had implications in terms of modelling disease in animals, so we use these transgenic mice. Since it's quite controversial, really, using animals to model disease, maybe people want to talk about that. It's not the sort of thing that everybody agrees with. It's also had an implication in agriculture because it's been possible to modify plants. And this has also been very controversial. And I would argue there's two reasons why it's controversial. Part of the reason is the technology has been so crude that really the only capability we've had for until recently is an ability to just transfer a gene construct into an organism's genome in a kind of crude and controlled way. There's no really control of where it goes in the genome. There's other reasons, which is the people controlling this kind of work, like people like Monsanto, have got very fixed specific interests about what they want to use this for. And that's had a big impact on the kind of type of crops that have been created. Often had no real impact on people, you know, on the sort of quality of food in the world, often exacerbating the problems of the environment. So people maybe want to talk more about that. In terms of animals, similar, you know, the ways of being able to use genetic engineering have been very much kind of, oh, let's make a supersized salmon, that kind of thing. And again, this has led to a lot of opposition. It's partly because I think people see this as unnatural and the rest of it, but also because, you know, the companies that are doing this, it's not clear that this is actually going to be really a benefit for people in terms of, you know, tackling world hunger, that kind of thing. But things have changed a lot in the last two or three years, really, and that's because there's now a new way of doing genetic engineering called genome editing that's really revolutionising our ability to transform genomes. And actually discovered it's based on a natural phenomenon that occurs in bacteria. Bacteria use it to combat viruses. But it's essentially this genome editing tool called CRISPR-Cas9, discovered and developed as a technology by two women, actually, a big plug for women in science here, Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuel Charpentier, almost certain to get the Nobel Prize for this in the next few years because they developed this. And it has the potential to transform biomedical research, medicine, but also agriculture. So how's it going to transform biomedical research? Well, one of the ways that we study disease and health within in human beings is that we model it on different organisms, everything from a nematode worm right through to a pig or a rabbit or a mouse. The thing is, up till recently, it's only been really mice that we could really do this kind of work with. Now it's possible to develop all sorts of other species. This is obviously very controversial. I mean, for the first time, it's now been possible to make a genetically modified monkey. Some people think that's really bad, you know, we shouldn't be doing this with primates. You could argue, well, actually, if we really want to model the brain, then primates are much more similar to us, well, we are primates, the monkeys are much more similar to us than, say, a mouse. And that's why this has been seen as a positive thing. Could have a big impact on agriculture. I said earlier on that we only had the very crude technology for changing crops and animals in the past. There's now the possibility, using genome editing, because it's such a subtle technique, of taking mutations that happen naturally in wild species and transferring these into commercial traits. So in this case, they've made a potato that's resistant to blight, the fungus that triggered the Irish famine. Now, that wasn't the reason why people then started to starve to death. That was as much the kind of free market policies of the British government. But it does involve a huge amount of fungicides worldwide to tackle this. And so is it possible we could use this is a strategy to avoid that. Similarly with making disease-resistant farm animals. There's also the possibility of using this as a new form of gene therapy. In the past, gene therapy has been a bit of a washout, really. But now with this new kind of precise way of modifying the genome, there are possibilities of tackling a whole range of genetic disorders, you know, cystic fibrosis, Huntington's, also cancer. I mean, this was a case of a North London baby, Layla Richards, who was dying of a very aggressive form of cancer. And scientists use this new technology to apparently cure the cancer. It's only one case, we've got to be a bit cautious, but certainly it seems to have the potential there. There's even possibility of using this to treat HIV, to knock out the HIV in an infected person. But it's also thrown up a lot of controversial angles. So one of these is that
There is actually a modification of this genome editing technology which would allow you to affect a wild population. Now this could be used in theory to make mosquitoes that carry malaria resistant to malaria. You know, so you might think, well, that'd be a great thing. You know, all the millions of people have died of malaria. But there are issues. I mean, do we really know what introducing a change like this into mosquitoes that carry malaria, how would it affect the ecosystem? There's so many kind of things, possibilities there. And that's why there's a lot of debate among scientists themselves about the value of this technology, how safe it is. Final things, I'm just going to wind up now by quickly rounding up the final things I want to say. It goes beyond this. It's now possible for the first time to engineer pigs so that you can make all, you know, transplantable organs from pigs. Scientists in America are even growing human organs in pigs, using the technology to make a pig so it can no longer grow a specific organ and then introducing human stem cells. This is also going beyond the kind of traditional labs. There's biohacking, so these are groups that have no particular background in biology but come together, pay money to do genetic engineering in their spare time. There's one in Hackney, you might be glad to know. Now, this could be seen as a good thing. Is it democratisation of science? Is it good that people are doing this in their spare time? I think that could be very positive. But you can understand why there are concerns about where this might be all leading in terms of security. The other thing I want to end on, really, is that for the first time in human history, it's possible to modify the genome of a human embryo in a way that is precise and is unprecedented compared to past technologies. But is this going to lead to eugenics, to designer babies? That's the kind of concerns. And these have been voiced by scientists as well as the people. So that's where I want to end, really. So there are so many different issues to consider. The value to humanity, the fact that people are trying to own this technology, there's a huge patent battle at the moment about who owns the technology. Is it really safe? How can we guarantee it's not going to be used to make some kind of biological weapon and not just taken over by a big company and used in a kind of way that's adverse to the environment? And finally, you know, how does this, the wants of an individual, you know, a parent wants to make a designer baby, versus social values? And the final thing I would say, actually, is also the first thing I said about the complexity of the genome means that whatever we think we're doing to the genome in a precise way, we've always got to be very cautious that actually things often much more complicated and the consequences are much more complicated than you might imagine. Thank you.
Thanks very much, John. Okay, that's given us quite a lot to think about. But now I'd like to introduce Suzanne Jeffery.
Okay, so just by way of clarification, I'm not coming to this as a scientist. I'm coming to it as a socialist, as a Marxist, as somebody who's, I'm not suggesting that John isn't, by the way, engaged with an environmental movement and also engaged with trying to change the world, as I hope that we all are in this room. So I'm coming to this debate and this discussion from that perspective. I suspect my scientific education is similar to lots of people's scientific education. It's very limited. It stops at about 16 years old, etc., etc. We're left to our own devices as to whether or not we continue to prioritise that, and you know, how do we find time in our everyday lives to read what is necessary and debate and discuss with other people. And I will be honest, I'm putting it out there for all kinds of reasons, so that you don't criticise me too heavily for my lack of scientific knowledge, but also just to locate that I think it is relevant. That this is a discussion that should not be the preserve of people with degree level scientific knowledge and understanding. In fact, that's quite the opposite. That's precisely why this is so important. The second way I'm coming to this debate is, as I mentioned before, I am involved with the environmental movement, as well as with that grander project of trying to change the world. And that's why I speak in a personal capacity, because what I articulate today are my own ideas, hopefully shared by some other people, but they're certainly not. I'm not speaking on behalf of a particular campaign or the campaign that I'm the chairperson of. And as I've been involved with environmental politics and campaigning, really I've kind of raised in my own head sort of a number of concerns about an approach to science taken by sections of the environmental movement or I'm going to call it green thinking, okay? Because it's very difficult for me to give a label to it, because I think it'd be unfair to give a label to it. And within green thinking, there are a whole number of different strands. I can't do justice to them. So I'm going to be very schematic. I'm going to pull out what I think are some kind of things that keep coming up as common sense interpretations coming from the green movement. I'm going to be probably overly polemical, so, you know, please take it as it is. But I kind of can't really think of any other place to start from in 20 minutes. I've probably used up 5 minutes of them already. So I think within green thinking, I think that there are a lot of ambiguities about science, and there is quite a lot of anti-science within green thinking. And I would probably sort of, in parenthesis, say probably what is stronger rather than anti-science is anti-technology. But the two have a relationship, obviously, to each other. So again, I'm being more than a bit polemical here. So I think that what happens, therefore, in terms of some green thinking, or a lot of green thinking, is this, that the problems that we face environmentally become human beings, science and technology, rather than, for us as socialists, class society, especially capitalism, and the limited potentialities and the problems of humans in that context, and therefore the limitations and problems of science and technology in that context. So I think there's a contrast in terms of what's regarded as the set of problems that we're facing. Similarly, therefore, there's a contrast in terms of the set of solutions, potentially. And this is, of course, the only reason of doing this is to clarify debate, to have debate, to move things forward. But as I see it at this moment in time, I would put it like this. That, for example, the solutions from the green thinking with the environment tend, therefore, because of the problems that are identified, to locate themselves within individual change. And there is still a strong sense of you start from within yourself, and if you're not able to do that, then you cannot impact. Secondly, it therefore tends towards localism, and there's a kind of a rejection of a bigger, wider societal change. And thirdly, there is that rejection of technology and science to some extent in various degrees. But what I find as well, sometimes simultaneously existing alongside a very uncritical view of certain types of technology. So for example, there's quite an uncritical view of renewable energy technology within the broader green thinking within the environmental movement. And I'll talk about some of the reasons why I think that is the case. I probably won't actually, because I probably won't have time. Okay. Rather than the solution for Marxists and socialists being revolutionary change, universal revolutionary change, so societal-wide revolutionary change, leading to a transformation of society with an end to class divisions, and therefore a use of science and technology as part of a positive human interaction as part of a wider nature, humans as part of a wider nature. So I kind of pose those two positions, if you like. Now, well, I think they're important because we're part of a growing movement. We all know the urgency that we confront the problems that we face, and it really is urgent. I've got to tell you this. I don't know if I've told this to a lot of people. Nobody's found it funny. I found it funny, but I've kind of set this up badly, haven't I? I was on a demonstration. I was handing out leaflets about climate change, which is what I tend to do. And can you know how you do? And you can't. You're not really looking at a leaflet. Take a leaflet on climate change. And this young man took a leaflet from me, and I looked up and he said, it's a climate change, so this is about how we're fucked, is it? And it really made me laugh, because it shouldn't have done, but there was a kind of insight there, an understanding of the urgency, the problems that we are facing, the dramatic scale of what we're trying to confront. So I think these debates are important. Now, I want to try and say a number of things about green thinking and how I think it's problematic in its relationship to science and technology, and pose as an alternative Marxist thinking around this. So I think, first of all, I think one of the problems in terms of green thinking is I think it establishes science as mechanistic, reductive. It establishes science as kind of Newtonian science, and then it takes therefore that science and it critiques that science, but then it also kind of asserts that as the scientific model, if that makes sense. So in a way, you end up not actually critiquing it, you end up restating it, and then that therefore becomes the problem. So you've restated you've stated the problem with some of that reductive positivist approach to understanding our material world, and then that serves as a critique. So you haven't actually explored the extent to which that is a successful science. You haven't really fully explored the sense to which there's an alternative set of scientific approaches. When in green thinking, I find that when that does happen, so for example, Einstein's theory of relativity is posed as a break, as a different a scientific approach, as opposed to be reductivist, positivist, instrumentalist, then that's not accepted as science. That then shifts away and becomes a philosophical, it moves into the philosophical realm. And this is not unusual. I mean, it happened at the beginning of the 20th century. So Einstein's theory of relativity helped underpin some major philosophical debates within the broader movement, and certainly within the socialist movement, where on the one hand you had a section of the movement retreating from materialism and realism to an anti-realist position, the Marxists, etc., and you have people like Lenin attempting to pull back again towards materialism. And I find that's what happens in terms of green thinking. So you take a model of science, which is not an accurate model of science, reductivist, positivist, things that have been critiqued, then you critique that and you say that that is science. And then when it comes to different models of science, you don't accept them as science, and you move away and you have a philosophical critique essentially proposing an idealist position and saying that that kind of those theories of relativity essentially give us an idealist version of the world rather than a materialist version of the world. So that's the first point that I would make. The second point that I would make, of course, and there is a different tradition. The tradition within Marxism are people like Engels, people like Lenin. So Engels, for example, rejected vulgar materialism, mechanistic materialism, reductionism and empiricism, but he also rejected idealism on the other hand. Marx does the same thing, Lenin does the same thing, and replaces it with dialectical materialism as a much more meaningful way of understanding the world and of engaging with science. How am I doing? Okay, so that's one thing. All right, second, I mean left or... Okay, that's cool. Okay, second thing, I think, is about method. No, perhaps it's not about method. Second thing, again, follows from it. So in that approach, that analysis that says science, that kind of Baconian science, that asserts that this is the scientific method, that instrumentalist method, then it was mentioned in the earlier session, therefore there is an assertion of humans and nature as being separate. That we as humans are observers of nature, that is the object, and we are the subject. And that is how we both conceive of ourselves, that is both the scientific method, and that is therefore both, that is then the critique of that method. Okay? However, there is another tradition, and it is a tradition which is not an idealist tradition, it's not a relativist tradition, it is a materialist position that says that that is not our relationship to nature, and therefore any method that flows does not allow that separation to take place, that we are not separate from nature, we are not observing a process that is separate from us, we are part of nature, and therefore we are part of that process as well as trying to understand that process. So we have this problem where they take classical science, or what's often called Western science, and just as a little in parenthesis, it kind of misunderstands Western science, so-called, because Western science has drawn on all kinds of traditions, so it's not quite right to call it Western science as such. But it does that, and then it says that humans and nature are separate. Humans are observers, humans are the observers of nature, that we're the subjects and they're the objects. Now, and then it kind of therefore reinforces that dualism, it reinforces that dualistic approach, it reinforces that belief that what we're engaged with here is an attempt to master nature, to dominate nature, to assert ourselves over nature. Now, there is a different tradition. And again, it was mentioned this morning. It contrasts with Marx and Engels' view, which sees humans as part of nature. I'll give you a quote here. The products of the human brain, being the last analysis, also the products of nature, do not contradict the rest of nature, nature's interconnections, but are in correspondence with them. So for Marx, there was an essential unity between man and nature. Human history was seen in the framework of natural history, and there was a continuity of methods grounded in this. One final quote from Marx. Marx lives from nature. That is, nature is in his body, and he must maintain a continuous dialogue with it if he is not to die. To say that man's physical and mental life is linked to nature simply means nature is linked to itself, for man is part of that nature. So apologies for all the men stuff. Human, I should have replaced it with. But it's trying to show that we're actually part of, we're not separate. So the methods that we employ absolutely have to replicate being part of nature, not being separate from nature, not being the subject over the object. Okay, so in addition to this, I think that green thinking actually regularly reproduces the dualism that they criticise by regarding, so I'm moving on to another point here, because they regard humans as uniquely destructive in relationship to nature, as uniquely destructive. Now, I really should qualify that, because that's kind of, you know, we are uniquely destructive in the sense of what is happening at this moment in time, but is that intrinsic in our condition, in ourselves as natural beings, or is that actually shaped by the types of societies in which we live? In other words, is there a human ecology, it was mentioned in the session before, is there a human ecology which has a kind of linear impact throughout time in our relationship as humans with nature, or is it a differentiated relationship that we have with nature depending on the modes of production, the type of societies that we are in? And certainly green thinking very much sees it as a one-sided, undynamic, linear relationship in which we are uniquely destructive over our environments, no matter what our environments are, which brings us to the question of technology. It's almost like, you know, the first time that we attempt to be human by using tools is kind of our downfall, almost, and there's no way back from that, because it's created this uniquely dangerous relationship. Okay, finishing up. Okay, so I'm going to finish up on this. So, a couple of points to finish up. And I also think that one of the issues in terms of green thinking is its non-dialectical nature. So, the approach to humans and nature, they are seen as separate. They're kind of joined together, but then seen as separate within green thinking. And it's a very undialectical view of nature, full stop, but also in terms of our relationship to nature. So that's not to say that it isn't dynamic, but it's seen as very static in a sense, that there's an equilibrium that needs to be returned to over and over again, and hence we become destructive over that equilibrium, which contrasts with dialectical thinking, which builds change into the heart of the dynamic within Engels' approach to nature, which builds change into the dynamic of nature itself. So, if we think about it like this, Bellamy Foster, for example, talks about, back to biologists again, having lost that kind of dialectical materialism that I've just been talking about there, having lost that to Marxism and to science to some extent. Then he talks about the work of Levins and Lowotkin, and he says, you know, in the work they present the notion of the organism as subject and object of evolution. By this they argue that organisms not only adapt to the environment, they also change it. They point out that it's often forgotten that the seedling is the environment of the soil, in that the soil undergoes great and lasting evolutionary changes as a direct consequence of the activity of the plants growing in it. And these in turn feed back on the organism's conditions of existence. In other words, within nature there is a modification going on. There is subject and object. That's not a unique position for human beings to be in relationship to nature. We are part of nature, and we're actually in very similar relationships to other parts of nature, to each other, wider nature. There is something unique about ourselves, which is the construction of our societies. But that is not timeless. That is not undifferentiated. In fact, it's strongly differentiated. So finishing up on a couple of points. So I think one final thing is that in green thinking, there's to link to that last point, there's a separation from class relations. So our humans and the relationship with wider nature, through societies, through labour, are often seen as a separate from class relations. In contrast, very strongly, obviously, with Marxism and socialism. Humans, particularly Western scientific thinking, is the problem, it is destructive. Rather than humans in class society, especially capitalism, which is uniquely destructive over the environment and ecology, because humans have become alienated from their productive process, the key process which shapes the relationships with humans and wider nature. But that is not seen within green thinking. It's seen as a common feature of all human societies, our destructive relationship with nature, our separation from nature. And therefore, changing class relations is not really seen as an answer, a solution. It doesn't open up any kind of emancipatory potential. In fact, sometimes the opposite. Existing class relations are seen as potentially emancipatory in a way that we just wouldn't see them. And I come back to the question of technology, for example, that although there's a rejection of science and technology often, there can be an acceptance of what is, you know, seen as positive forms of technology. Green technology kind of, you know, very much is playing that role at this moment in time. So it's an abstraction from class relations, both in terms of historically, but also it's an abstraction from class relations in terms of seeing what the potential for change is and how change could and should occur. So I'm going to finish up on these points here. And I think it is, therefore, to just come back to where I started from, I think it's therefore important, incredibly important, that we kind of revisit some of these debates and some of these discussions. Not just in the brilliant way that Bellamy Foster has done by looking at the kind of ecological insights of Marx, but I think also looking at some of the philosophical and political debates in the late 19th and the early 20th century of the broader, you know, political and philosophical movements, but particularly of the socialists and the Marxist movements, because they were attempting to grapple with those questions. They were attempting to grapple with the question of science, of the importance or otherwise of understanding our material world. They were attempting to grapple with the emancipatory potential of science or otherwise, as well as obviously trying to grapple with the question of how do you fundamentally change our society. So I'd like to conclude with saying I think these debates are important. And I think we need to look at them in much greater detail with much, much fuller kind of examination. They're ones which allow us to begin to think about not the instrumental potential of scientific thinking, but actually the emancipatory potential of science and scientific thinking. They're ones that allow us to think about human relationships with nature as a relational one, because nature is integral to human beings and human lives are only conducted as part of and in relation to nature. Therefore, relationships are contingent on the circumstances, and there are a number of potentialities, positive and negative. We can see the negative potentialities in the relational situation of humans and nature at the moment in time, but I think we have to assert that there is a positive potentiality in the situation, but one that does derive itself from a broader project of revolutionary change, of changing class relations, of asserting human beings with democratic control over their own control over the metabolic relationship between ourselves and nature. And I did want to say this. Now, why have I said to finish here? Yeah. So, one, a lot of the kind of what I've been trying to assert here, and notwithstanding the kind of work that John does, and there are others out there, but it is very underdeveloped, I would say, in that kind of that joining together of a kind of philosophical thinking about things back again with the natural sciences and how things are progressing.
I want to just mention here, for example, this what happens when this does take place. So if you look at the work of Christopher Caldwell, young British socialist, killed in the Spanish Civil War at a very, very young age, but he really had tried to engage with the kind of debate that I've been trying to discuss. And his important work, which contained and developed the traditions established by Marx and Engels with the natural sciences, wasn't published by the British Communist Party until after his death because of criticisms that he made of Lysenko, the kind of Soviet-style approach to science. In his work, Caldwell rejected, and this is really what I'm trying to get at, he rejected the repeated generation of idealism and mechanical materialism, not as true antagonists, but as pseudo-antithesis, generated as twins in the same moment of conception, or rather as the same fractured moment of thought. So in other words, we keep you know, flipping is essentially from mechanical materialism to idealism and flipping back again, and he's saying there's another tradition that allows us to transcend that and actually begin to think about the real possibility of transformation of society and the real possibility of humans being part of wider nature and living as part of that wider nature, not with all negative potentialities, but actually with huge positive potentialities for ourselves and the planet and the people and the lives that we live with, human and animal.
To both our speakers, and I thought they were both very thought-provoking. So obviously now is the opportunity for people to make your own contributions, ask questions. You might want clarification of the ideas that John and Suzanne were talking about. I'm sure.
I'd like to. I read Matt Ridley's populist book on return, and I regret that very much. I'm about to get yours. I really want to prepare for this, as Suzanne said. My science stopped when I was about C physics. The other thing is, thank you to Suzanne for giving that schema, which was basically toing and froing from the idealist and the mechanical historicist, or rather materialist. But I haven't read John Bellamy Foster, but what I do want to demonstrate is that at the present moment, what we have is quite frightening in the sense that scientific knowledge about life, about nature, is being used not just for profits and to further capitalism, but to control who get to live and who get to die. Mm. Basically, it's the future generation that they are going to create and so on. And it's a nightmarish thing, it's very Frankensteinish. But coming back to what John Parrington said about the mosquito and malaria carrying and all that. I have what is called a recessive gene that is resistant to malaria attack, and that has I gained it from generations and generations of genetic crossbreeding, really. But the problem is this. I cannot, because I have this recessive gene and I pass it on to my son, if I were to have a baby with someone who's got a similar gene, then there is no child involved. Now, these are the possible dangers where you separate things instead of letting them integrate and evolve over time and et cetera, et cetera. Okay, coming back to because the question I want to focus on is this. Zuckerman and his wife recently wanted to give money to say, look, we want to wipe out all diseases in the world and so on. The problem being is that people have gone on radio and saying, to say, what about the human population? There's going to be like, it's called, the whole point about nature and everything is that it's going to be a self-sustaining system. If you have disequilibrium, problems are thrown up. One example being is that they found a way of dealing with resistance to antibiotics. This 25-year-old female scientist, she created this polymer. If you're going to apply a polymer, that's an extant outside force coming into the body. It's going to change. So to cut the story short, the question I wanted to ask John Parrington is this. Is it possible that there's a way to manipulate cell destruction so that it appear that the destruction of populations are natural, as well as starvation, as well as war, as well as this, and it's like deliberate state execution, but it's the case that it appears to be natural illnesses?
Thanks very much.
Okay, so I completely agree with Suzanne about the reductionism of the green movement. I find it quite anti-science quite often, and frequently this idea that if something doesn't occur naturally, then it's bad. And there's also seems to be a real... So Monsanto are obviously a capitalist company. They do whatever suits their profits. But then it's because Monsanto do gene editing gets just thrown in. So something like golden rice or BT wheat, where golden rice produces extra vitamin A and can help reduce blindness in various populations where that's an issue. It's been held back for years and years by what I see as an anti-science movement. And there's always an argument about what about the unintended consequences? What about the slippery slope? What will happen next? And I think it's as if people believe, oh, it's just some guys tinkering in a lab, and then they just release it and see what happens. I mean, with the mosquito example, they have done, there have been studies done to see what effect, if mosquitoes don't reproduce, because that was the angle they were going for with the modification of mosquitoes, how will that affect the food supply, the food chain that they're part of? And it was seen that it wouldn't have an enormous effect, and not a massive food source. So it wouldn't necessarily be, in that particular instance, it would be all bad, but it's just like there's... It's just that people seem to, or at least in the green movement, seem to think that no one thinks any further on. They're just doing experiments and throwing out these odd things. And also, when you mentioned eugenics, it seems the same kind of simplistic view of science. I think you're guilty of there suggesting, are we leading to eugenics? I mean, when you talk about gene editing, it's not like we know there's a gene for height and there's a gene for your weight, a gene for exactly whether you'll get cancer. Now, it's all just, you might have a slightly higher risk, but as in when you're talking about epigenetics, it's the environment influencing how genes are expressed, surely. So it's not like we're so far from eugenics. I don't know if it's even a worthwhile debate having.
Yeah, it's about the contradictory role that science plays, because the odd thing about science is both venerated by people and the object of horror for people. I mean, science is also the Samson phone that blows up in your pocket, as well as this great salvation for humanity. And I think that's replicated in the green movement, as Suzanne was saying. You get both people who fear everything to do with science on the one hand, you also get lots of people in the environmental movement who look for scientific quick fixes to quite deeply entrenched problems of the capitalist system. But we have to understand that both sides of that coin are not the products of people's ignorance, they're the products of the way in which science actually takes place in a class society. Because if you think about what science is a special case of what Marx meant when he talks about human labour. Because Marx talks about human labour as a collective, conscious attempt to work on nature to transform it through practical means. Precisely what science is. It's a form of labour. And we know from our understanding of labour in general, that labour takes place in deeply alienated circumstances, subject to the control of an alien force, and with these kind of separations between mental and manual labour, and so on and so forth, which tend to make science seem like an alien thing in people's lives. And because of that, it's subject to all kinds of distortions. At a very practical level, who actually controls science? Well, by and large, big businesses and capitalist states control science. At a more subtle level, the ideological distortions that are introduced from Newton and Darwin onwards, which gives science this undialectical, mechanical, and often reductionist quality. However, there are two very important points I want to make about that. The first point is this. Good science often pushes against the limits of that reductionist, materialist way of looking at science, even when the people conducting that science are not Marxists and not dialecticians. You study physics in a university, you don't just study Newtonian physics, you study thermodynamics, quantum mechanics, and so on. Very, very dialectical ways of understanding the world. Secondly, it's my final point. Science is not something we want to reject, but we're not uncritical of how science is practiced in a capitalist society. We want to reclaim science as part of a method of reclaiming capitalist culture in its totality, revolutionising it, pushing it forwards, and using it as part of human labour to solve real problems that human beings face. Our project is not one of rejecting science, it's reclaiming and revolutionising science.
Couple of things. The frustrations I've been having with people within the green movement over the last few years. Things about the GM crops, for instance, I found it a deeply frustrating argument that we were getting into, because to me, they were rejecting it completely, and to me, it was just a matter of timescales that we were talking about, how you change one crop from one to another, because we've been, every crop that we've got out there has been manipulated by human beings for over 10,000 years now, so it's just a matter of time scales we're talking, and control. And then they turn to us, the same green people turn around to us and say, what we need is to grab the energy coming out from the sun for the use of solar power. Now, I agree with them. You can have all the rooftops in London and Birmingham and Manchester and all around the world covered in solar panels, and that would generate an awful lot of the energy that we need. What's going to be the side effect of that? What are the solar panels made out of? How are you going to get rid of them? Are they biodegradable? I doubt it very much. Etc, etc, etc. Them arguments are not coming up within the green movement. So it's, and also what we need to do is actually look at the funding that's happening in science. Because I don't know what percentage is actually coming from the military, but it's a very, very high percentage of money that is funding science is coming from the military regimes, and that is something that we need to be extremely critical of. Because I was looking at John's thing there, and I was thinking, that's great, that's brilliant, you can cure all sorts of diseases there, but I'm thinking, perhaps you can also generate some genes that could be used by the military complex for rather nefarious purposes, so to speak.
Yeah, I was just going to sort of make a point, and then people have already sort of made it, I was going to say a couple of things. Firstly, about sort of, how it is absolutely not the case, as people have said, that science is either good or science is bad. It is absolutely sort of what happens with science and what is done with science is absolutely rooted in sort of the system that we kind of live under. If you think about something like, nuclear, like physics and our understanding of how, of the structure of the atom, for example, where does that... you start off, obviously that's something that's gone on for hundreds of years, but then you sort of get to about the 1930s and they work out that you can get energy out by splitting an atomic nucleus or whatever. What do they use that for? Because we live under capitalism and that generates competition between nation states and therefore you get this drive to war, they use it to make really massive bombs. Whereas actually, if we lived in a socialist society and that drive and that sort of imperialism, that drive to war didn't exist, we probably wouldn't do that, even if we knew everything about how the atom worked. And the other point was just to come back to what Joseph said about quick fixes. I went on, a couple of years ago, I went on a trip to, a school trip to this, there's like a nuclear fusion research centre in Didcot. And sort of the thing with nuclear fusion, the idea is that you sort of get hydrogen nuclei to kind of fuse, and that generates a lot more energy than you get from splitting uranium, and you don't get any of the radioactive waste products, it's supposed to be safer and blah, 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 blah. While we were sort of, so there's a lot of research that's gone into it. The problem with it is currently it doesn't really work. You have to put more energy in to get it to work than you get out. So you can't use it to generate energy. But the woman doing the sort of introduction when we got there was going on and on and on about this, how it was going to be this magical, wonderful solution. And then right at the end she goes, and we can get electricity from this on the grid by about 2050. And you're going, great, okay then. And we climate change might probably be too far gone by then. But and then she proceeded to slag off renewables, and it was all a bit like, oh, okay then. But just the quick fixes.
Yeah, I just wanted to argue against sort of anti-science as a practicing scientist, etc. I agree totally what people were saying before about how science and technology really has to be under the democratic control of ordinary people. But we shouldn't blame scientists for, things like the nuclear bomb, etc. Albert Einstein, Peter Higgs are all against nuclear weapons. They were very sort of active fighters. I think the important thing is what we need to do is defend, you know, the scientific method, and that will help us understand. It will help us understand how we, you know, the sort of things we talked about this morning about how we repair the metabolic rift that capitalism has introduced, that Marx talked about. You know, scientists, by using the scientific method, actually can undermine the dominant ideologies of the time. You know, with Darwin, for instance, with his, he really undermined the Victorian creationist ideology at the time, which was used by the church, which essentially controlled, if you like, the thinking of the time. And then more recently, if you think about the example I like is the one about the ozone hole, the depletion of ozone in the upper layers of the atmosphere was discovered by a chemist who looked at the various processes, postulated that would happen, and it wasn't. And DuPont, what he proposed was that the reason was these freons, fluorocarbons, which are used in fridges, which were manufactured by DuPont. DuPont launched this massive campaign undermining the scientific studies that have been, that have been progressed by these people in their labs, we're able to sort of by sheer force of their power, of their arguments, etc., and their economic power, able to quell it. And it was Joe Farnham, who was on a really tiny budget, worked for British Antarctica Survey. He was getting something like £5,000 a year, and he flew a plane through the atmosphere above Antarctica and saw that the ozone, I haven't got time to go into all the details, but rigorous observation showed that this hole was appearing. And that led to the Montreal Protocol. There was a meeting about it yesterday. The Montreal Protocol, where it was shown that, where DuPont were told, basically, you have to stop making these freons. And now there's definite evidence the ozone hole is starting to heal. It's starting to come together over Antarctica. And this shows the way that we can fight, you know, fight the system, if you like.
Have indicated for quite a while, so I'm going to call them. If I've got time for any more, fantastic, but I don't think I will. Come back here. Yeah.
Just very, very quickly, one of the two words I regularly hear when I'm bringing arguments about the destructive nature of human beings in the world are the words human nature. It's an argument I have time and time again when we're discussing things like why wars occur, why humans destroy to the planet, why nothing is being done about it. And I have to say, no, it's capitalism that does this. It's not human nature. Human nature's got nothing at all to do with the destruction of the planet and the wars that have occurred and so on and so forth. You know, it's not in our nature. And it's an argument that we probably all hear now and again. So it's just, I just make that short point.
Yeah,
I
want to go back to this thing about science as a cultural practice. And of course, if you're in a capitalist society, you practice capitalist science, whether you like to or not. And I think that's very important, you know. So it's got this dialectical nature. It's got this two-sided nature. I mean, I was on the bus yesterday coming back from work, and I was on, you know, on my computer, my phone, and this story came up about, you know, that scientists have discovered there are 2 trillion more galaxies than astronomers previously thought. And I thought, yeah, I thought it was a bit more room than I was accustomed. That's wonderful. It's a wonderful achievement, is it not? That we can do these things. But of course, you know, that's not what science does under capitalism. You know, it's got this dual nature. And that pulls on the practice of scientists, whether they like to or not. I mean, Gandhi used to say that his favourite invention was the Singer sewing machine, because Mr. Singer developed it out of sympathy for his wife watching her sort of sew at night and whatever. So he came up with this machine. brilliant, except capitalism turns it into the sweatshop, doesn't it? You know, they take it and they use it for their own reasons. You know, we know that most research, medical research, is to cure the, you know, it's the aspirins, it's the things for headaches and maladies on a quite low level compared to the horrible diseases that destroy poor people, because poor people cannot pay for it. That's not the scientist's fault, that is the cultural practice of it. And, you know, just like take a little issue with the comrade who says that science can undercut ideologies. That's true, but of course science has reinforced ideologies. You know, Darwinism may have attacked the idea of, you know, creationism, but actually they used it to boost the ideas of racism as well. It is a cultural practice. We'll only get a socialist science under a cooperative society. We support science. I think it's great that people want to know things, because that's something I have encountered going out to the movement, that the problem is that we want to know things. I think it's great that we know there's 100 trillion more galaxies in the universe than we previously thought, but actually a proper science won't develop until we have a proper society, a proper cooperative society.
I just wanted to say, in regards to philosophy versus science, I would say that essentially any subject, when you get into the highest level of it, becomes a form of philosophy. And you can really see that in the really advanced experimental, or rather theoretical science, that essentially there's in many cases very little actual scientific methodology that's going into it, because the scientific methodology can't cope with what they're doing. When they're finding that in order to come up with a new model to explain how a particular thing works, they have to re-envisage the way that that these things are represented in order to find a way that they can actually apply the scientific method to that. So that's very much a philosophical process rather than a scientific one. And I would say that philosophy essentially runs through the whole of science, but it's something that, as I say, is separate from the scientific process as such. I think that we really need to find a new way to identify science as a whole, so that we can hold on to the scientific process while at the same time giving real consideration to what is scientific and what isn't scientific, because otherwise it can lead to horrendous things I'm losing the ability to speak now. It leads to a lot of really negative processes when it isn't actually being directed towards something that's necessarily desirable within society. I'll leave it at that.
Okay, we need to give our speakers a chance to come back, but hopefully I can get in a couple more people. The man in the striped t-shirt, do you want to say something?
Just two bits which I think get thrown into all this and confuse things even further. But people might remember a few years ago the discovery, a paper was used which discovered a statistically significant polymorphism on the long arm of the X chromosome amongst a relatively small number of gay men. You might not remember that. What you will remember is on every tabloid newspaper was the discovery of a gay gene. So the science behind that actually has come under lots and lots of questioning anyway. The problem that we have is that people can be making very, very serious scientific breakthroughs, but the way in which they get reported in the popular press and so on a daily basis, plays into other ideas about things like human nature or an essential makeup of, your genes are the root of everything, or the idea of the human nature locked in your individual personality rather than society and so on. So you get this distortion of science. Not only is it in the service of capitalism to a large extent, but also it gets distorted. And the other thing, which I think will be part of the discussion today, is a real problem area when it comes to the idea of science and technology being locked into the idea of growth. So you have people in the green movement who reject the idea of growth, because that's tied up with technology and that's tied up with the production of commodities and so on, and that's a bad thing. What they miss out is the driving force of that growth is very, very specifically related to the accumulation of capital. So there's a series of problems which distort and confuse, I think, the whole debate about the relationship between science and socialism and the different sorts of society that we can have in the future.
So somebody said socialism is the rational control of our metabolism. I fully agree with that. The question is what that means. This is very open, it can mean very different things. My take would be there is no scientific answer to that. It's a question of values, political priorities, what a meaningful life is, etc. And so there's no scientific answer. What can socialism mean? Well, to go to speak, it's the kind of democratization of the control of science. With the suggestion, well, in the future, everybody in his garage or his kitchen or her kitchen will be able to engage in genetic modification, etc. So we don't want science to be controlled by some strong power centers. No, science should, technology should be democratized. But if that is our view of science, of socialism, I think it's an awful dystopia, right? And not just because of security reasons. Of course, it's dangerous. Everybody can just freely start to modify or a genetic pool, etc. Security question, but there's much more than security in this debate. It's also a question about what society we want and what kind of types of human beings we want. Do we all want to be engineers? The democratization of engineership, is that what we want? I think a socialist human being is somebody else, takes another position, has another kind of subjectivity than the one of the manager or the engineer. And I think that is also part of the debate. And in that sense, from Marxist, etc., but I think we have much, much more to learn from green thinking despite all its flaws and its problematic aspects. Because at least they engage in that debate. At least they have started the critique of science. And it is true that capitalism is the motive behind the development of science, but it's much more complicated than that. Even in a socialist science, you will have huge pressure to engage in more and more far-reaching forms of technology. You will always find one or two ill children who need a kind of special medication which opens the door for new dangerous technology. So there are other mechanisms as well. And so we have to have a reflection on science as such and not trying to reduce it all the time to capitalism and its dynamic. Sorry.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much for a really fantastic discussion and debate, comrades. I'm going to now give John and Suzanne the challenge of coming back on those. And if I can start with John.
Yeah, thank you. A really interesting discussion. I think one thing that's important to say is that many scientists themselves actually see beyond the kind of typical reductionist framework. Reductionism is a very valuable thing to science in the sense, you know, breaking things down into its individual components is actually quite an important way of discovering more about a system. I think the problem comes when you think that is all you've got to do. You really do have to, I think, especially for complex systems like the brain or embryo development or even metabolism, you really can only understand it as an interacting whole. And I think the more that scientists, you know, start to look at big questions like, well, how does the human brain, what the human brain and human mind, they're realising that reductionist methods are only going to take you so far. Even things like metabolism, we're learning that the bacteria in our guts actually have a major role to play in our health, and there's an interaction going on there between us and our bacteria. There's actually 90% of our body and cell number is actually bacteria, so we're more bacteria than human, actually. Now, this complexity, so I think we need to engage with the scientists who are actually grasping for this new ways of interpreting nature. But people are right to say that often the way that science is presented in the media, and often by some scientists themselves, is very crude, it's kind of distorted, and it's also, you know, reinforcing the ideas of capitalist society. I mean, the gay gene is a good example, actually. The science for that was really flawed. There's no evidence for a gay gene. I'm not saying that homosexuality doesn't have a biological component, far from it, but certainly this idea you can just reduce it to a single gene doesn't, you know, you could have said the science was bad just by looking at the paper. Interestingly, as far as I remember, that study was actually led by a gay scientist. I think there was an element of the gay community that saw, somehow, if we can show that we're biologically different, then you know, that will stop us being oppressed, all these things. It hasn't stopped black people being oppressed, you know, the fact there's a biological difference between black people and white people in that sense. But I think he was driven by that sense of, well, if we can show it different, we'll stop being discriminated against. Actually, I think, you know, more we learn about sexuality, the more we realise it's a spectrum and you know, it's far more complicated than a simple either-or thing. And this thing about complexity is, I think, one of the most valuable things that's come out of the genome project. You know, there were people like Stephen Morris who wanted him. Were against the genome project because they were so much looking at the way it was being justified in kind of you know, bourgeois ideology, the rest of it. But actually, the more we learn about the genome, the more we understand that that cuts against these simple ideas. I mean, people mentioned, you know, links to disease, the rest of it in the genome. Is it, you know, the environment? Is it genetics? Obviously, there's a complex interaction going on for many so-called disorders between the environment and the biology. But even when we look at the actual biology, it's complicated. I mean, we've been led astray where we're looking at those simple gene disorders like cystic fibrosis and Huntington's, where there is kind of a single gene involved. The more we look at other things like it's heart disease or diabetes or so-called mental illnesses like schizophrenia or bipolar, the more we realise that the genetics is incredibly complicated. And actually, there's an interaction going on between complex genetics and the environment. Apparently there is one part of the genome, you know, that may influence certain people to become more schizophrenic, but only if they smoke cannabis when they're teenagers. Now that's a very subtle thing, because it's saying, well, actually there is an environmental link. That probably explains why there may be a link with cannabis, and it also explains why most people who smoke cannabis as teenagers don't become schizophrenic. So that's just one example. So I think that poses challenges when we talk about using genome editing to, you know, to cure disease, in the sense of, well, first of all, if we don't really understand if the genetics is so complicated, it's not as simple as just, you know, changing a switch. And the other thing is, the more we learn about the biology of things like creativity, genius, all these things, the more we realise that it overlaps with the biology of mental, so-called mental illness. So actually, you know, trying to change a person's genome could have completely unintended consequences. Raised the question about, you know, could this kind of technology be used to kill people, you know, to wipe out populations? I'm not really into these conspiracy theories, actually. I mean, I think there is definitely the potential for all of these discoveries to be used in either negative and positive ways. It's interesting that there's been a lot of talk about whether this could be used to make new biological weapons. And I think that is a concern, actually. I mean, it is now more so accessible. It's so easy to use compared to past technologies. And also, it's interesting that when there have been kind of, you know, things like there was these anthrax letters after the 9/11 bombings, that was originally, the finger was pointing at, you know, Iraq. It was used to justify the war in Iraq. Actually, it turned out that had been developed by, they'd been sent by somebody who worked in for the US Army. So it just shows. But again, I think what we can do as activists is start to demand scrutiny, start to demand, you know, that we have some democratic control over the way these technologies are used. What else can I say? This thing about humans changing the world by creating technology, if I give the impression that isn't compatible with sustainable, you know, approach to the world, then that's a false impression. I think these technologies open up so many different possibilities. They could be used in sustainable, ethical agriculture. There are people out there who are trying to use them that way. Equally, they could be used by a company like Monsanto to just dominate the agriculture system. So I'll have to end now. It's all to end. I think the final thing I'd say is that, for me as a socialist, one of the things I find striking about the capitalist system is, on the one hand, we can sequence a baby's genome in 50 hours now. We can use that to, you know, potentially treat a very sick baby. On the other hand, we've got babies who are dying for lack of clean water. That's the big contradiction in capitalism. The capitalists themselves, many of them have grasped it. Bill Gates has grasped it. The problem is, they haven't got the means to do anything about it, because it's not a controllable system. It's an anarchic system. Only we, as activists building a socialist movement, can actually do something to really, you know, forge into a completely different kind of site. And I think these new technologies can have a massive, fantastic role to play. But we'll have to control them. We'll have to be in democratic control. But that shouldn't stop us trying to fight for reforms in the here and now. We want better medicines. We want better vaccines. We want better drugs. All these things we should be fighting for in the here and now.
I think that I don't think we can or we should reduce the question of science to capitalism, most definitely. Perhaps a better way of looking at it is to think about science in terms of class relations more broadly, not just in terms of capitalism, but earlier class societies as well. But I want to pick up on just one of the points that Joseph made earlier on as well, about there is a contradictory nature of science, but there is also a good science that pushes against the limits of ideology. And I think that's maybe a compliment to what you were saying, or maybe even a challenge to what you're saying, I don't know. Because I think I do find that green thinking can reject that idea, can reject the idea that science can push against the limits of ideology, and that is
it is a worthwhile, one, it's a possible thing that we know and understand the world around us and its dynamic and it's the way it works and our relationship to it. One, that's possible, and two, that it's, it has a good potentiality. And I think that is sometimes rejected. So I just want to reassert that point. But there is an issue. So again, we can't simply we can't simply absolve a science as it presents itself to ourselves in its current class class relations and class structure. So this is what your point right at the very beginning about Monsanto. You know, and the only problem is that, you know, all this great technology, however, is just looked at by this horrible corporate beast. And I think it is a little bit more complicated. It's a little bit more complicated than that, because there are real concerns. John finished on them. It was raised earlier about, you know, what would happen, how could this technology be used, what are the dangers of it, is it really advantageous to humans cohabiting with their wider nature, all of those kind of things. So I don't think we can simply locate it in terms of, because it's, you know, it's seen, although that is an issue. And one of the things that I just want to raise, suggest, is that your point about science and philosophy, I think, is a really well-made point, that a lot of scientific endeavour is philosophical endeavour. But I don't know what the right word is, and John, you know, feel free to correct me, but just in terms of what I read, I sometimes feel that there is a kind of antithesis towards philosophical engagement and political engagement more broadly within the scientific community. So I'd like to suggest, because I feel it around the environmental movement, you know, I'd like to suggest that wherever we can, there should be forums, opportunities for people to come and locate debate and discussion about science within a broader philosophical and political discussion, and it will raise lots of questions. It will continue to raise lots of questions. But that was the kind of beauty and the pleasure, if you like, of what the movement at the end of the 19th century and early 20th century were allowed to happen. It created this space where those kind of debates could happen, so we don't have quite the polarity and the duality that we have at this moment in time. And I just think we've got some of those opportunities revisiting themselves because of the nature of the environmental crisis. It's so deep, it's so profound. Just a small account, really small anecdote. We, campaigners alongside myself, helped to organise a demonstration in March of last year called Time to Act on Climate Change. In other words, trying to assert the urgency of the situation. And I read a blog afterwards about the demonstration. Young man, scientific student at Imperial, who sort of was kind of really upset that there hadn't been like a scientist block on the demonstration. And I actually went to meet with him and chat with him about it. And I kind of thought, well, actually, he's got a point. How brilliant it would be, and how it would open up debates and discussions when you see scientists engage in that kind of wider political, philosophical discussion about what needs to change, why, what will work, what methods do we have that are working at this moment in time. Just two final things. Your point about the vision of nature and feeling that maybe some of what's been said from the platform doesn't correlate to earlier. I don't know. Maybe it does, maybe it wouldn't. But I that's what I was trying to say about it. I do think in Green Think there's an undialectical sense of nature. It can be seen as quite static, an equilibrium that we are negatively disrupting, and therefore we have to look at how we maintain that stasis, that equilibrium. So can end up being, you know. And I think that's a problem, because nature changes, has always changed, will always change. It's not about can we control nature. We can't control nature. That's just, forget it, that is the ideology of capitalism, that somehow we have these techno fixes, we can assert our domination over nature. I completely agree with that. That's not where I'm coming from at all. But we will modify nature. We always have, as human beings, we always will do. As indeed other animals, organisms, species do. That's what I'm trying to say about a dialectical relationship between ourselves, others, society, nature, all of that kind of stuff. So it's not about whether we will modify nature, it's how do we do it, and for what purpose do we do it. So it comes back to sort of some of your points about values and the aspiration of what kind of system we want. Just final point on what you're saying about the democratisation of science. You see, I think that kind of model that you just talked about, everyone doing a bit of genetic engineering in their garage, I don't see that as the democratisation of science. I see that as a localisation of science, which I think is a very, very different thing. So when I think about the democratisation, I think about a kind of universality. I think about a collective voice of are people, of humans, who actually have some control over the metabolic relationship between ourselves and nature. And I see that as a democratization of science rather than the kind of localized cyclization of science, which is a lot of in terms of, you know, how science is conceived moving into the future. And I hope that's what we can begin to continue to and need to continue to debate about, but not taking too long to debate because we've got a lot to do. Very quickly.